welcome to Crossroads Church. Come on in and join us. We're about to sing together. Love for you to join us. Come on down front. There's plenty of seats. You can hear better down here, too. And Pastor Chris has prizes for those people who sit in the front. So here we go. Singing, y'all. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. Singing to God here. Comfort those in need. That's me. Up always like eagles. Lift him to the top. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. May be seated.
Welcome to Crossroads Church of Dunwoody. So glad that you are here. Now, we have an opportunity today to be able to interact with one another. We have a luncheon right after. How many of you are planning on staying for lunch this afternoon? Yes. If people around you don't have their hands raised, in just a moment, go attack them and drag them to lunch today. If you're a guest with us, we're thrilled that you've chosen to be here with us. You can do one of two things for me. You can go to guest.gift and fill out a little information, and we're going to give you a free gift for being here and some information about our church. Or you can go to the information table out in the lobby that you right to the right as you're walking out the glass doors. It's right to the right. There's a VIP team there willing to receive you and give you some information about our church, and they'd love to just get to know you for a little bit. Well, I'm glad that you're here today. We have much to celebrate because God is good. And He is in our lives, and no matter what we're going through, He is more than enough to meet our needs. Let us pray together, and then I want to have you give you an opportunity to fellowship with one another. Father, thank You for Your grace to us. Thank You that every morning there are new mercies. Father, we know that so many of these things in our life are bigger than us, but nothing is bigger than You. And that's why we pray. That's why we interact with You. Father, we lean upon You. We rely upon Your name. I pray that You'd meet us at our point of need, comfort us where we need that, and Father, challenge us where we need to be growing and motivated to move forward. Father, in all things, may You get the glory and we get the overwhelming joy of knowing that You have us for eternity. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you stand up and just greet those right around you, give a hug, shake a hand, fist bump, whatever best communicates.
No other fount I know.
Lord, we glorify your name. We glorify your name in all the earth. Sing that again. We glorify your name. We glorify your name. Yes, we glorify. Your name is a shelter like no other. your name. Let the nation sing it loud at us. Come on. Cause nothing has the power to say. Praise your name today, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated.
We're in a series here at Crossroads, walking through the Ten Commandments out of the book of Exodus. If you have a Bible with you, go ahead and turn into the book of Exodus, chapter 20. We're going to be looking at verse 7 today. Some may question, why would we even spend any time in the Old Testament, and specifically the Ten Commandments? Isn't it that little outdated? We live under grace, and I've explained this for the last couple of weeks, but even this past week as I was just studying, I was reminded of some of the Old Testament covenants, the Abrahamic covenant, the Adam's covenant with God, but then even Moses' covenant. And Jesus said this of Moses' writings in John chapter 5. He said in verse 45, "Do not think that I will accuse you before the Father. For the one who accuses you is Moses, in whom you have set your hope." They had a high view of Moses and his writings, the Old Testament. But he says, "But if you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me." The purpose of Moses' writings was to point towards Jesus. He didn't name him as such, but it was all the testimony about Christ, the one who was to come. Moses was known as the rescuer, the one who came to Egypt and led the people out of bondage. But he was just a picture, a foreshadowing of Jesus who comes for his people to rescue them from the bondage of sin. Jesus says of Moses' writings, and Moses being the one who wrote the first five books of the Old Testament, known as the Pentateuch, the law, the Torah, "For he," Moses, "wrote about me, Jesus. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words?" Why is it important for us to study the Old Testament? To give us greater insight into who Jesus is. To give us, you know, the first two-thirds of the Bible is the Old Testament. If we understood more of the Old Testament writings, I believe we'd have a better understanding of why the New Testament is so important. So I pray that today that God would give us insight into his Old Testament teachings to give us a New Testament understanding. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for your word, every jot and tittle, from Genesis all the way to the end. Father, we need to cherish the very words that you have given us. For there is no other words on this planet that are as valuable, as perfect, as inerrant as your words. And Father, I pray that not only would we embrace them, Father, may you give us an enlightenment, an understanding of them, that we might be able to apply them with a full understanding, a New Testament vantage point, seeing the beauty of Christ in the Old Testament. As we walk through these Ten Commandments now today, looking at verse, or number three, help us to understand the beauty of your name and cherish it, because no other name under heaven is used that we can be saved by. So, Father, I pray that you would give us this wisdom and this insight, and, Father, this joy of knowing who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Names are important. What is in a name? You know, in my collection of books, both in my office and in the parlor and at home and various other places. Many of you have borrowed books and never returned them. So I've got books all over the country. I have both theological books, and I have books just give me better understanding, and I also have a few oddball books. And one of the books I've got is called What's in a Name? It's written by Paul Dixon, but in here he is he's an obsessive name collector. When he runs across names, he jots those down, things that are unusual about that name, or maybe the name they have with the position in life they have. And so just wanted to just say that I've got the book, but I pulled out a few that I thought was kind of interesting, because names are important. He was talking about how sometimes our vocation is perfect for the name we were given at birth, like a baseball coach. His name is Joe Bunt. Bill Dollar, who was an accountant. These are real names of real people. Dan Druff, who was a barber. Dan Druff, yeah, okay. Jeff Treadwell became a podiatrist. Bill Mailer was a collector of overdue accounts. Harry Smiley was an orthodontist. True stories here. The last names of two individuals, Goforth and Ketchum. They were police officers and partners. O'Neill and Prey, two men who got together and they built pews for churches. There was Wonderfully Trembly, literally first name, last name, Wonderfully Trembly, who was a psychologist. Will Crumble, he was a contractor. Not quite sure I'd hire him. There was Zoltan Overy, who was a gynecologist. I'm not making these up. I got them in the book. I can reference them after the service if you need to. Here's a urologist named P.P. Peters. I'm not kidding. In Montreal, there was a window washer who died. This was in the paper. He saw this in the paper. Montreal window washer who died accidentally while he was washing windows. His name was Will Drop. In 1941, there were two men who were executed in the electric chair in the in Florida State Penitentiary. Their names, last names, were Wilburn and Frizzle. How important are names? Names actually do matter. And now you consider your name. Are you aligned? Is your name aligned with your vocation or your hobbies? What's in a name? God believes his name is very important and that it ought to be valued. It ought to be honored and revered. So he says in Exodus chapter 20, verse 7, we'll put the verse up on the screen. It's the third commandment of the ten. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God, the name of the Lord your God, in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. It's a short verse, but a powerful commandment that I still think still applies to today with a New Testament understanding of the Old Testament. To understand, we have been saved by grace through the name and blood of Jesus Christ. So how much more valuable should we hold his name and to revere that name? Why is God so sensitive about his name? God says that his name represents three things, and I'll throw all three of these up on the screen. First, his name is about his reputation. You know, God's known by various names, Yahweh being his personal name, but he has many names in the New Testament and the Old Testament. But his reputation. Have you ever heard people say, well, he's making a name for himself? He's getting a good reputation about some individual in your world. Sometimes our name has a bad reputation, and therefore, when that name is mentioned, certain identity is established. If I were to say the name Hitler, would you name your child Hitler? No, because that name has a reputation. If I said Martin Luther King Jr., if I said Abraham Lincoln, certain names carry a certain weight of either good reputation or bad reputation. And for God himself, he says, you need to value my name. Don't hold it in vain. Don't use it in vain, because it maligns my reputation. Also, character. What you do often represents who you are. We've all heard of Honest Abe, as I mentioned, Abraham Lincoln. In the Bible, names were often changed because God was transforming that person from one type of characteristic to another type of characteristic. Abram became Abraham. Jacob, his name meant deceiver, was changed to Israel, meaning prince of God, child of God. Simon, in the New Testament, which means reed, you know, one of those that blows in the wind, his name was changed to what? Peter, which means rock, solid. Because of what God was doing in his life, he moves from a blowing reed to a solid rock. It's his character. So when you malign God's name, you're maligning his reputation, his character, also his authority. If a police officer is running after you, he's going to say, "Stop in the name of the law," because it carries authority. He didn't say, "Stop in the name of Bugs Bunny." Stop in the name of the law. It carries authority, that name. There's authority behind that name. If you received a call from Nathan, your wife picks up the phone and says, "Hey, Nathan's on the phone." You're like, "I don't know a Nathan. Just take a message." And then she goes, "No, it's Nathan Deal, the governor, and he'd like to speak to you." Well, will you take that phone call? Maybe not. I don't know. It depends on your if you're in trouble or something. But a name has authority. Any old Nathan won't do, but if the governor called you, the president called you, the boss of your company called you, it means something different. It has authority behind that. And when we malign a name, we're maligning the authority of who God is. His reputation, his character, his authority. Today I want us to observe in the scriptures some vain ways that we do use his name, that we ought to be leery of and change our ways. And then I want to show you some valid ways to use his name according to what the Bible says. God's name is important. He wants you to honor it and value it because of its authority, its reputation, its character. Let me just give you a few ways that we use his name in vain. The first one that most people think of is swearing. All right, so we swear. We use his name in vain. We use it as a curse word. So swearing. Somebody said if cussing and cheating were crimes, then golf would be illegal. I agree. There are times where you feel like you got to express yourself in a different way. But unfortunately, we use God's name versus just calling out some other name or some other vile word. Have you ever noticed that our culture is becoming increasingly foul-mouthed and vile without shame? I mean, it used to be they even had barriers to when you could use certain words on television, but I'm not sure that's valid anymore. There'll be even earlier in the day, I'm hearing language on the television that would never be allowed even after 10 o'clock at night. It's sad that our culture is so embracing it, and no one even bats an eye anymore. Even music CDs have to come with labels warning of explicit language, and our teenagers are buying these up, unfortunately, and adopting that language for their own. The most well-known garbage mouths in our society are what we call comedians. And they somehow can get away with it because, well, it's just comedy. Comedians can speak about politics, they can curse, they can use God's name in vain, and people pay them to do these things, and we just laugh at it as if it's okay, it's actually enjoyable. You consider how comedians may say a lot of things, but when they use the Lord's name in vain and we laugh at it, what do you think God thinks about those things? You saw verse 7, "Do not use my name in vain. He will not hold you guiltless, he who uses my name in vain." His name is valuable. In his name is where we praise. In his name is salvation. In his name is who we know who he is, his reputation, his character, his authority, and to malign it as we do. I wonder why people swear as often as they do. Even people in this room, let's be honest. I believe it's a lack of emotional control at times. Sometimes it's a way to impress others because that's just the common accepted language in the group you're with. When a child swears for the very first time, they think they're pretty big stuff. But the fact is, it shows really how small you are. Limited vocabulary. Any idiot can curse and use God's name in vain. You don't have to have an education to do that. You just, a three-year-old can learn to use the Lord's name in vain and just parrot it out. You can teach your bird, the same parrot, you can teach your bird how to curse and use the Lord's name in vain. It doesn't take intelligence. It doesn't take IQ or education. Swearing doesn't show maturity, manliness, or even liberation. It's basically just stupid, I think. When people swear, rather than invoking the name of Buddha, invoking the name of their boss, invoking the name of their mother-in-law, whatever fits, they curse the name of God, they curse the name of Jesus, and it's accepted. Go to a Muslim country and curse the name of Muhammad and see what happens. They hold that name very precious. It takes maturity to discipline your speech, especially when you're angry. You stump your toe, you hit your thumb with a hammer, you get cut off in traffic. It takes discipline not to swear, and it shows maturity and self-control by not responding and taking God's holy high name and bringing it down and throwing it into the mud. Swearing is a way we malign his name and we use it in vain. Here's the second thing. I'm going to just call it showing off. Showing off. This is when people use God's name as an excuse for their own ungodliness. They act like they know God so well that he actually doesn't require of them what the Bible actually teaches. They'll use God's name in a way, well, I've talked to him. I know it's okay that I'm doing this. And kind of showing off that disobeying the Lord in his word. They excuse themselves and they actually blame God. Oh, God doesn't, I've heard this, God doesn't want me to honor that contract. God doesn't want me to pay my taxes. I've had people say this to me. God doesn't want me to do that. Really, where in the scriptures do you see that? He's excused you from obeying the laws of the government. Taking God's name, like I know him so well that he's given me an excuse why I don't have to do this. I'm in such good relationship with God that he doesn't have to require of me what he requires of everyone else. God says that I can leave my spouse. God says that I can lie to my friends. God says I can disobey my parents because it's for a better cause. Here's a common response. When I've pointed out what the Bible says, they say, well, I hear what you're saying, Pastor. I hear what you're saying, Chris. But I've prayed about it. And Jesus just wants me to be happy. Doesn't he? I think Jesus wants you to be more holy than he wants you to be happy. But in holiness, you will find your greatest joy. In Titus chapter 1, verse 16, it says this, and I think there's the warning for those in this showing off category, claiming the name of God and applying it to their unrighteousness. In Titus 1:16, it says, they profess to know God, but by their works they deny him. Oh, I know him. Oh, I prayed about it. I have an excuse why I can do this. They have a good vocabulary, but a poor obedience to God's word. Insecure believers do this a lot. They try to prove how spiritual they are by their spiritual cliches. Do you ever feel like the more you use the name of Jesus in a sentence, the more spiritual you are? I just say Jesus a lot, or God, or use different, even Hebrew names, then I must know something. Because people do believe this, because I get to talk to them all the time. I'm riding on an airplane, I'm sitting at the doctor's office. Once people find out what I do for a living, the vocabulary just transforms. And they're able to say so many names of God while I'm sitting there going, wow, that's so impressive. As a pastor, people try to impress me, especially when they want something from me. Almost on a daily basis, people will come to our church for benevolence. And so they'll have this incredible story that they want to share with me. Some are legit. Most are not, unfortunately, because we do verify. But they'll come in and they'll say,
Bless God. You're a wonderful man of God. I can just sense the Spirit upon you, Pastor. I just want you to know, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. I just need you to pay all my bills. They wax eloquently of all the language of spirituality. And when I began to ask them, well, so you're plugged into a local congregation, you're praying, you're with some other believers, or is your church helping you? And no, I haven't been to church in years. Or they'll say, yeah, I go to so-and-so church. I go, who's the pastor there? Pastor Jackson. They'll just make up a name. And I'll say, well, let's look that up on the internet. Maybe I'll call him, because I'm certain that your pastor would want you to know that you're struggling, and he wouldn't want you to just go to another church for help. Certainly we can assist if it's legitimate. But they just show off with other language, but by their deeds, they're really denying him. I'll ask folks, you say you love the Lord, he's number one in your life. What have you been reading the Bible lately? How is your prayer life? How's your finances in a sense that you're giving to the Lord? What ministries are you involved in right now? No? You know, talk is cheap. We can all use spiritual language. But I was in Missouri for a while. We learned this one phrase. It was our state motto. Show me. Show me, then I'll know if you really got it. If you're really living for the Lord. So showing off doesn't do anything. And we take God's name and apply it to our situation without really knowing him and not listening to him. Here's the third way we use the Lord's name in vain. We use it selfishly. You saw a little taste of that in this last description of showing off. But selfishly, another way we use God's name is to use it selfishly, where people will say, well, God told me what you should do. I need you to change. Spouses will do this. Parents will do this with children. God told me to tell you to do this. And oftentimes I think, well, I just spoke to the Lord this morning. He didn't mention it. But I'll go back to him and discuss this. Well, God told me what's wrong with you. God told me you're supposed to lend me money. God told me you're supposed to adjust this. We have a whole slew of these folks on television. If you want to see that, you can turn on this afternoon and see people that will use God's name to tell you what you're supposed to do that actually benefits them. Very selfishly. If you'll write that check, I know you don't have any money in your account right now, but if you'll write that check in faith and send it to me, the Lord will bless you. You know, I've got a $4 million home. And if you'll write that check, I guarantee God's going to get you someday. Maybe it won't be on this earth, but God's going to bless you someday if you'll just bless me. And people will use God's name to manipulate, to intimidate other people because they want to use his authority for their own selfish reasons. What do you call it when someone uses someone else's name to get what they want? In the banking industry, if I take someone else's name and I sign it to get what I want, it's called forgery. In art, it's the same thing. If I take something and I write someone else's name on a piece of art, it's forgery. It's the same thing in the spiritual life. We have a lot of spiritual forgers. They take something that they want, something of themselves, and they attach God's name to it, forging it, trying to give it the authority that they know they don't have. And people succumb to this. I wonder how many times that we are guilty of that ourselves, forging the name of God to get something for our own personal benefit that gives him no glory and ultimately will not give us any joy. Fourthly is this, spontaneously. This is one that many people fall to. Spontaneous means doing it without thinking, using his name without really thinking. I'll give you some examples. Using God's name as a convenient expression of fear or anger or joy or amazement or surprise, not particularly cursing, perhaps, you know, that this would include that, but just using God's name just as a filler word. This is fairly popular among our young people, but perhaps even yourself. I've heard this on television as well. You know, somebody has something exciting to say, like, I was with Don Thompson and I caught a 10-pound fish. And someone will say, OMG.
It's just a filler. It's an expressive word. It's an exclamation point. Not really using God's name in the honor it's due, but just using it as a way to have to, some kind of response. Oh, so-and-so's pregnant. Oh, my Lord. How are they going to handle that? What's going to happen with that? I just lost my job. Oh, whatever, fill in the blank. When you're reducing God to the level of a wow or an oh no, you've used his name in vain. You're not really recognizing him. You're not thinking about him when you say it. It's just a spontaneous response without much thought and certainly not much praise. God's name is to be taken seriously, not flippantly. Using God's name so spontaneously without any real meaning is lowering his name to simply a filler word where you could have plugged in any word and been just as effective. Also, in the Bible, it talks about lengthy, meaningless prayers being just as bad. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 7, it says, "And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words." Have you ever heard someone pray like this? "Oh, dear Jesus, we thank you, Lord God, for the great day, dear Father. And Father, we thank you, oh God, oh Lord, you just are the super one, that just wonderful God. Thank you, Lord Jesus." And they just throw in all these words. And it sounds spiritual. But as I've considered that, I wonder if that's what he's saying about Gentiles. Gentiles want to be recognized by the Jewish people, so we're going to throw out every word of God that we know and put it all into a couple of sentences. If your children came to you and spoke to you like this, would it seem odd to you? "Oh, Daddy. Chris, you're just the most wonderful father. Dad, Chris, Father, I'm just the son that's honoring you, dear Daddy." I mean, how many times does he have to address me before I'm like, "What? What are you talking about?" Don't misunderstand me. I believe it is right to use various names of God to address him. But I wonder if when we get where we're not sure what we're supposed to say, we just start filling the words that we do know that are really meaningless when we say them. We hope that we'll be recognized just because we're able to say a whole bunch of words. "Oh, Adonai, Father Yahweh." You know, I think God would just rather you address him, Abba, or Father, or "Dear Jesus, hallowed be your name." And then move on to what you want to speak to him about. Don't try to impress God with just repeating his name 100 times as if the incantations get more of his attention. His name is precious, but not to be devalued by multiple meaningless repetitions. You don't have to use God's name every other word. Just talk to him directly. Jesus says when you pray, don't use a lot of meaningless words. When in Matthew chapter 15, verse 8, Jesus said, "The people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." When we pray to him, is it more about our lips flapping or more of our heart just being open and confessing to the Father? You ever prayed before dinner, but you didn't really consider what you were saying? You just did it because it's rote, what you're supposed to do? You ever sang songs to him, such as times today, but you couldn't remember what we just sang because we really didn't think about the words? I mean, how many songs today did we sing about your name? "Blessed be the name of the Lord." Hopefully it was starting to focus you on how valuable his name is. But sometimes we just say words and the lips are moving, but the heart has no connection to God. This is a way we dishonor his name and use it in vain. See, God is serious about his name, so much so that he put it as number 3 in his top 10 commandments. Why don't you consider Leviticus chapter 24? See what it says about his name. "Whoever blasphemes the name of the Lord shall surely be put to death." If we just stopped right there, how many of us would no longer be here?
All the congregation shall stone him, the sojourner as well as the native. When he blasphemes the name, shall be put to death. God is serious about his name. And I think if we honored his name more valuable, more holy in our society, I think that the church would be recognized as maybe odd, but committed, in love with the God on high whose name is worthy, because every knee will bow before this God. He will be recognized as the only God who can save. So these are ways that we can dishonor him, that we use his name in vain. And I ask you to consider just in your own sphere of influence. Are you the one who influences people in the negative way, or are you in a position where you can influence in a positive way? The fact is, all of us, I think, need to bow our heads and apologize to God. No matter how we've used his name in vain, I believe all of us have been guilty of dishonoring his name in some ways. But let me give you some positives here. Let me give you some valid ways that we can use God's name. I mean, there are consequences for misusing his name, but the Bible is full of promises and blessings for those who honor his name. Hundreds of verses. If you'll honor and reverence my name, I will bless you, he says. So what are some valid ways? Here are three of them. Number one is this: revere his name. The Bible has many verses that would say basically the same thing, but in Psalm 29, verse 2, it says, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness." Holiness being set apart, different than all other. We ought to use his name with the utmost respect. We ought to use it very lovingly when we express it. Using his name is an act of worship. It's so holy the Jewish people wouldn't even utter his name. Yahweh. When you say God, mean it with your heart as an honor to him. When you hear others use it in a derogatory way, I would not participate in laughing at that or brushing it off. People say, "Well, it doesn't bother me that people at work do that. It doesn't bother me, but you know, some of my family members do that. I just don't listen to it anymore." Let me ask you: if you were in a group of people, and they were saying words that you wouldn't necessarily say, but then they started cursing your spouse's name, using your spouse's name as just a way to blow off steam, would you say anything, or would you just laugh? We say, "Oh, it's not that big of a deal. You can curse my wife's name. I do it all the time." Would you do that? No, if they started treating your children that way, using their name as a curse word, would you just say, "Nah, it's not that big of a deal"? I know it may be uncomfortable. I mean, years ago, Jennifer and I were with another couple, had attended church with them a few times, and they were somewhat related to me in a weird way. I'm not quite sure how that all connected, but somehow we found out we were connected somewhere down the line through one of my mom's marriages. So we had gone out to dinner with them, and we were driving home, and this individual, the guys were in the front and the girls were in the back, and this guy had a little bit of a temper problem, an anger problem, but he was a very frustrated driver. I'll just never forget that. He just got mad at everybody. If somebody cut him off, he'd just kind of lose it, and if he didn't get to be first in line, or if the car didn't start right when it was supposed to in a sense of the green light, he just let his lips fly. And then he got into this pattern where he was using God's name in vain, pretty consistently, you know, G-D, G-D, G-D. And I'm just sitting there, and I said, "I've had enough of this." You know, they knew that I'm in the ministry, but what do I do? I don't know them all that well, but, you know, certainly we're related, and I think we're building a relationship with them. So finally, at one of the stop lights, when everything was quiet for a few moments, I just happened to look at him and said, "Well, contrary to popular opinion, God's last name is not Damn. His wife started laughing. He did not. He looked at me. He said nothing the rest of the trip. And to my remembrance, I don't think we ever got to go out with him again. It offended him. But the entire time, what was he doing? He was using the Lord's name on high. This is a guy who had been attending the church and all, and he just stepped on it threw it in the mud. And I couldn't handle it anymore. I'm not the vocal police. I'm not running around looking for people. I go, well, you know, by the way, contrary to popular opinion, you know, I'm not doing that. But in that position, I thought, you know, I've been friendly with them. I'm being nice to them. I'm building a relationship with them. But there's a relationship far more important to me than my relationship with this individual. My relationship with God is the top. And I didn't correct him in a way that was rude, saying, well, how dare you do this? God's going to, you know, I can take you out and stone you now. You know, I didn't do any of that. I was just letting him know in a subtle way, you know what, God's name is far more important than attaching it to a curse word for your anger and your poor expressions. I wonder if you'd be willing to do that. I'm not saying go to a restaurant today and call out the guy who's sitting down a couple of tables from you. Actually, today we're eating here. So if somebody does that a couple of times, get up and go tell them, stop. But I'm saying, people you're in relationship with, you love, people in your family, don't be, you know, the word police, but let them know how valuable and precious the name of the Lord is. The God they're cursing is the God who died on the cross to save them from their sins. Tell them how precious. Because let me tell you, we in this world may curse his name, but you know what he does? You know, he knows every star by name. He's named every star. And you know, how many stars are there? And he knows us by name, and he never maligns our name. In contrast to what we do with his name, he calls us by name to himself in relationship to save us and to treasure us. I think the world needs to hear how great God is. And that if we understood him and what he does for us, I don't think we'd be using his name in vain. And the world would have something to celebrate and to revere. A valid way to use his name is to revere his name. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Here, let me give you a second one. It's to represent his name. This is where you as a believer, a follower of Christ, can have much influence. It's not just to revere it for yourself, but to represent him well. Our lifestyle either promotes or diminishes his name. Wherever we are, if we call ourselves a believer, we ought to act like it. Don't drag Christ's name through the pigsty by your lifestyle. Your life needs to represent him well. I've heard it said that there are basically two reasons why people don't become Christians. Number one, they've never met one. And number two, they have met one. Reasons people don't become believers: they've either never met a Christian, or perhaps they have. Listen to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. It says, "Let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity." Separate yourself from sin. He goes on in verse 22, "So flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, along with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. Have nothing to do with foolish, ignorant controversies. You know that they breed quarrels." If you're going to attach yourself to the Lord, if you're going to call upon his name for your own salvation, it says, then depart from sin. Don't live like that anymore, but rather embrace the things of God and represent him well. If you claim to be a follower of Jesus, represent him in such a way that they can clearly see who he is. Here's the third one. Not only represent his name, but to rely on his name. How many of you, when you were a kid, had your mouth washed out with soap? Anybody? I know we always threaten that. We've got a few. Can you still taste it? Go back in your memory? Here's the problem with that. It only takes care of here. And Jesus said very clearly, it's from the heart that the mouth speaks. And so if a parent could take the heart out and wash it, that would be good. But here's the thing, that only God can truly transform the heart. We can wash a mouth out with soap, and hopefully there'll be some type of behavioral change. But ultimately, until your heart is transformed by Jesus Christ, you'll always have a mouth problem. So we rely on him. Out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. So let me give you a few ways you can rely on his name. We rely on his name for salvation. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, "And there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we may be saved." We rely on his name for confidence, confidence to live in this world. Look at what Psalm 9, verse 10 says. And those who know your name will put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. We rely on his name for joy. Psalm 33, verse 21, for our heart is glad in him. Let's go on to the next couple of slides here. Go to the next one. For our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. Our joy comes from knowing him and knowing his name. We rely on his name for prayer. In John chapter 15, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, the authority, the power of Jesus' name, he'll give it to you. We rely on his name in our prayer lives. Without his name, without him personally having the authority, the reputation, the character, we would have nothing. God tells us that there are many valid ways to use his name, so there's no reason for us to misuse his name. We ought to repent and apologize for misusing his name. We ought to review and what we allow to influence us and remove what is not honoring to God when they devalue his name. We ought to recognize God's presence and his position in our life and call upon his name far more frequently than we do. The third commandment, don't misuse the Lord's name in vain. I want us to call out to his name right now, just honoring him. I want to give you about 30 seconds just to, in your own heart and in the place where you're at, just to call upon his name and just make your relationship with right with him. In whatever ways you've been using his name, make a commitment to him that you're going to honor and reflect his name well. God, your name is precious. It is holy. Your name you revealed to us that we would honor it well. We would represent it. We would cling to it. Father, when parents have their first child and that child is growing and they begin to utter some noises, they long for that moment when that child says, Mama or Dada, the name of the one who's been caring for them. Father, you knew our name, you've called our name, you've provided a means for us to grow and development of who we are with our name. But Father, you long for the day when we would call out to you, Abba Father, honoring you, the one who has provided for us, the one who has protected us, the one who calls us into personal relationship and provides eternity in heaven with you. If we'll just repent of our sins, trust in Jesus Christ by faith. Father, in our lives as believers, where the world may continue to malign your name, but Father, as believers, let us embrace your name, obeying this commandment, but not out of obligation. Let us embrace your name out of privilege that we know who you are and we are kept by you. Father, may you be honored in this place and in our lives. Father, as we observe the Lord's Supper in just a moment, the communion table, celebrating the name of Jesus, Father, I pray that you would do a work in our hearts. And Father, if there are people here that have never surrendered to you, have never received Jesus Christ, Father, I pray that they would pause and consider that today. I'm going to have some prayer team members here at the end of the service to pray with anybody who wants to receive the name of Jesus for their salvation. But Father, I pray that you would do such a work in our hearts that we would never malign your name again, but every day we would call upon your name for all of our needs and celebrate who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Our deacons and elders would come forward preparing for the communion time.
Let me remind you as we prepare for the Lord's table, it's open to all believers who have publicly confessed Jesus as Lord and Savior in their life. And let me remind you that there's two cups, one with the bread, one with the juice. Be sure and take one of each.
I'm excited about what the Lord has in store for my nation, my church, and for me personally in the year 2017. The Lord's table is the perfect place for us to examine ourselves and our relationship with God to be sure we are ready for the opportunities God has for us. God prepares us as we study His Word, as we pray, and as we fellowship with fellow Christians. We must ask ourselves if we need to be stronger in any of these areas. Jesus said this, "Do in remembrance of me." As we take the Lord's Supper, we should remember the sacrifice of Christ. 1 Peter 3:18 says Jesus gave his body as payment for our sins. When he said, "Do this," he is extending to each of us to meet him at his table. Each time we break the bread and drink the cup, we say, "Jesus is Lord." As we partake of the Lord's Supper today, I'd like to think of this quote from a pastor who asked his mother why she never missed the celebration of the Lord's Supper. She looked at him very seriously and said, Our Lord asked his friends not to forget him. I'm one of his friends. I do not forget him. We gather today at the Lord's table as friends of Jesus, and we remember his direction to us. This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat. This is the covenant. The cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Take and drink.
Father, as we come to you today, we thank you first and foremost for Jesus, our Lord and Savior. I thank you for this church and the people that I can fellowship with and grow in your will for my life. I pray now, Father, that as we go in fellowship in a meal, that you would bless this food to our bodies and not certainly our bodies to your service. Be with us this week, Father, that in everything we do, we bring honor and glory to you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Y'all have a great day, a great week. We'll look forward to seeing you back here next week.